morning, everyone. I think we'll make a start, even though there's a few people still outside. The time has come. It's great to gather again to rejoice in what Jesus has done and is doing for us. The key's here, so I'll ask the question, how was your week? How was your walk with the Lord?
Fantastic.
So it should be. That's great to hear, Keith. We're going to start this morning with a video clip of Keith Green doing the 23rd Psalm. Before we launch into the program, I just want to check something. Hello, hello, hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Ron usually has a dig at me when I do that. But it does serve a purpose. Someone told me last Sunday, having morning tea, that they couldn't hear me when we were doing the singing. Or couldn't hear me properly. And I thought that was a bit strange. But then someone else told me this week they couldn't hear me when they were watching the service recorded. And I thought that was rather strange. So music practice yesterday, I checked the microphone and went, hello, hello, hello. And nothing was coming through. So even though I turned the amp right up, nothing happened. So worked through the system and found that the lead where it plugs into the microphone was sitting there but wasn't pushed in properly. So when I did the sound check last Sunday, it might have just been touching. Then we moved the microphone and it lost contact. So I was pleased I found out what the problem was. So you should be able to hear me today. If you can't, stick your hand up. Why even tell me? That reminded me, really, that no matter how well we think we are doing, we're not achieving much at all if we're not soundly plugged into Jesus. And what's interesting, if you're here for the pre-service music, one of the songs was His Banner Over Me. Sorry, His Banner Over Me is Love. Ron and Janet chose that one not knowing my microphone was going to play up, but that's fine. But we only went through it twice, so we didn't get to verse 4. Who knows what verse 4 is? Nobody knows what verse 4 is. That's terrible. What I'll do, Stephen's great at signing. I've not had a lesson in it, but I'll have a go. Something visual for you. Ryan remembers verse 4. That's right. He, you remember that sign from the 70s? He is the vine, and we are the branches. And his banner over these lives. Is that right, Ron? Yeah, that's right.
I was told this morning I shouldn't do that, but I couldn't help myself.
You should listen to your wife sometimes.
The reason I'm saying that is that echoes some verses from John chapter 15, which I'd like to read to you, which relate to being plugged into Jesus. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit, for apart from me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches that are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to me my disciples. Those words, I think, are both challenging and encouraging. So, let's remain plugged firmly into Jesus so that we might be fruitful and not cast away. Let's pray. Lord, as we gathered here in your name today, free us from the distractions of our daily lives and the pressures that we face living in this broken world. Focus our minds on your word and your love for us. Help us to understand what it is to be a branch on your vine, to trust you and abide in you. Amen. As is our habit of late,
I'd ask you not to sing, not to dance vigorously or anything like that, but we'll sing our first song now, All Around the World.
You can stand though if you'd like. Let's stand.
All around the world, the kingdom cry resounds from mountain to town, to desert plain, from city to the shore. The truth will not be bound by walls upon the earth, from every nation, tribe, and tongue, God calls his people. The land. Restless is the world, unchanging is his word, unshaken is our confidence in Christ the risen Lord. All who bear his name unite to breathe as one.
We have a new ministry, and that is something that's required in these times, and we need to clean all hard surfaces, in theory before and after the services. That's correct, is it? Just before, phew, so it was a big ministry then, it's only half the ministry. So if anyone would like to be involved in that, and we are thinking of connecting it with whoever's on welcoming, so that is also something to look at after the service and see if we have some volunteers to do some welcoming there. Do you want to say anything more about the creek and the community garden at this stage?
It'll be coming out. Sorry, there's a newsletter, leaflet, whatever it is that the community garden group is going to put out. What's happened is the creek area and the community garden have sort of become involved in the whole project. And the community garden group is seeking volunteers, or people interested in the whole project. And we're going to start with the creek area. So those who've volunteered their names to me as being interested, what we might be doing is asking you to, when this newsletter comes out, get in touch with the community garden people to volunteer, so you can be part of it that way. And that should be coming out in the next week or so, I think.
That sounds about right, yes, yeah. So, Jim, is there anything you want to say about the meeting today or anything other than...
About the...
meeting this afternoon? So we have church after the service.
An annual general meeting in a way, because we've got to re-elect deacons and elect a new deacon.
Okay.
So it really will be an annual general meeting.
So it's a bit of an AGM. So that's at 11:30-ish, we're looking at doing that, so there is an agenda ready to go. So we'll try and make it as quick and as informative as we can and just give you an update of where we are up to. So yes, that would be great. So 11:30 sounds good. Gives us time for some morning tea, and then we can just move straight into that there.
Well, it depends where the sermon's finished,
doesn't it? I'll try and do a shorter one and listen to my wife. It might be something we could both learn, Warwick, listening to our other halves. We could say it like this, that straight after the AGM, there will be a screening of God's Not Dead at Ron's house for all of those who are interested. And that's a really worthwhile movie to watch, God Is Not Dead. It's not only is it a true story, but it's actually quite informative on our relationship to communicating what the good news is. So it's a great tool that we can use. As you notice and would be used to now, the offering box is at the back there. Or if you'd like to avail yourself to giving online, you can talk to Ron, and there's quite a few people now who are doing that. So you're welcome to look at James. And we're nearing the end of James. So as we sort of come nearer to the conclusion, I might call us to read together just softly. The words are on the screen there. If you'd like to join me, we're going to read from James chapter 5, verses 13 to 20. So if you'd like to follow me. Is any among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is any among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well, and the Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being, even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. My brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth, and someone should bring that person back, remember this: whoever turns a sinner from the error of their way will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sins. We're going to sing. You can remain seated for this if you want. But I'd like, as we lead into this song, this is 10,000 reasons. And I never quite got why they said 10,000 reasons, but they actually reflect in the last verse the number 10,000. So I'll leave it at that. Other than to say, just before we sing or as we sing, maybe just reflect on that old hymn that says, count your blessings. So let me give you a moment just to add up at least 5. You don't have to say those out loud, but in your own mind, I'd like you just reflect on 5 at least, not 10,000, but 5 reasons that you would like to bless God or thank God for.
Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
It was on the spot, so I thought five might push it when you're on the spot, but 10,000 reasons. Father, as we look to these holy words that James has written down for us, our minds really are stretched to consider that this man who wrote this not only knew of Jesus, but grew up in the household Jesus, that watched Jesus all of his life, that not only as a big brother, but he came to see him as a Lord and as his Saviour. Lord, that James learned wisdom from you, Father God, as you revealed yourself in Jesus. And now he has called us to consider our lives before you, our Heavenly Father. So, as James constantly says, we need to examine ourselves, our hearts, our thinking, our motivations, our love or lack thereof, for not only you, but for each other. And so, Lord, you know that we have grieved you, we have grieved each other, and we've grieved people around us. So as we begin to look at your word, I ask that you would forgive and cleanse, fill us with your spirit, and then lead us, that we might not only represent faithfully your heart and character, that you might empower us with confidence and boldness to minister in the name of Jesus. So I ask this, and I ask that you would help me to speak clearly in Jesus' name. Amen. There's some interesting words in here that make you ask questions. Is anyone in trouble? Well, what sort of trouble is James talking about? Is anyone happy? Well, in the light of the persecution of the churches that James is looking at, what does he mean by are you happy? If you're sick, sick of what or sick from what? And then he certainly says, well, call the elders. So who are these special elders who will come over to your house and anoint you with oil? And are we really going to pour oil over each other's heads? I mean, there's so many questions that sort of strike my mind as I look at this passage in practicality. And then he goes on to say, you know, this prayer that is offered in faith, this faith prayer, will actually make the sick person well. Do we really think that that is true? Is that a guarantee that if you call the elders then and they come and anoint you and pray in faith that you will be healed? What is the promise here? And then he throws in, and if you have sinned, you will be forgiven. So as we look at James, there's a few questions here that come, and it's right at the end, because now he's wrapping up. He's bringing to an end and a practical outworking. He's talked about trials and persecutions, about suffering, about steadfastness. He's talked about being tempted, about your own desires that have enticed you or led you aside to do things which really you know in your heart you shouldn't have done. He's talked about quarrelling and fighting. He's talked about selfishness and greed. He's talked about unanswered prayers. You pray and you don't get. Why? Because you don't really believe, or when you do pray, you want it for yourself. So he's really identified a lot of things. He's talked about being wealthy and self-sufficient and thinking that my life is all tied up in my own ability and my own supply. And then he's talked about the poor and the impoverished and how we treat them. So when you come through all of these sort of parts, and now you get to James chapter 5, you get to the real practical, well, what do we do? It really is a culmination. And three times now, in these few verses, he says, pray. Pray. You can hear the reflection that when James in chapter 4 verse 8 says, if we draw near to God, then God will draw near to us. So all the way through all of these commands, really, James is trying to encourage us to respond by drawing near to God. In other words, when everything is shaking, that you hang on to, as Warwick said, that you abide in the vine, that you stay connected to Jesus. Now I want you to remember, as James writes this, and this is, I was sort of wrapping up and looking at this passage, and I reflected at the beginning, James grew up with Jesus. And so what he writes here, and we actually have a letter that James, the young brother of Jesus, who followed Jesus around, we have a letter from his own hand that we can read 2,000 years later. Is that in and of itself not astonishing, that we have a document, a letter to the churches scattered that is so relevant to us now? So as I said, three times he calls us to pray. Are you in trouble? Then pray. So you could actually translate that word suffering, because it is literally that word trouble there. It's the same word James uses elsewhere in this book on suffering, particularly in verse 10. So he says to those who are suffering, are you suffering? Then pray. There's a sense to which this first call is for you yourself to take responsibility, although responsibility is a bit of a chore word. It's really the privilege that you have to pray. And let me just reflect, for instance, in Romans, that our prayers are not this formula, our prayers are not this perfect outworking of I know the answers, but our prayers are a leaning on, or as the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want, knowing that God shepherds us, that God cares for us, that God supplies for us. So we personally, face to face, talk to God. So James is, are you suffering? Are you in trouble? Are you stressed? Are you pressed down? Then pray. And I reflected on Romans, because what he says there is that God's Holy Spirit intercedes with God. So the Spirit who knows us, who's been placed in us, intercedes with words or groans that we can't even express. In other words, your prayer might sound like, oh, amen. It is the very fact that you are groaning towards, lamenting towards God, that is powerful and an evidence that God is present, with a confidence that the very fact that you lean into the arms of God, that you are his child and that he is your father. So let them, in other words, you can pray. Sometimes, and I feel like this sometimes, that I shouldn't really pray for myself. Not only that, I feel embarrassed when others pray for me. But he says that you should be praying for yourself, for your own troubles, for our own struggles, for our own sufferings. I think that's something that as Christians you need to hold on to. You can pray for yourself. And in fact, you are called here, James says, let them pray. But he adds to that, it's not just about being in trouble. Is anyone happy? Interesting, some translations say cheerful, some translations say well in spirit. So you may be able to sing that hymn, it is well with my soul, even though the world has fallen out from underneath you. Are you steadfast? Then sing songs of praise. And in this context, I would say he's saying, are you cheerful? Are you happy? Are you steadfast? Then pray. But the nature of that will be praise. So the first part there is saying, you pray. But then he moves on quickly to verse 14. Is anyone among you sick? Interesting, because at two levels, the word sick there is used a whole lot of times in the Bible. The same Greek word is used there for weak or feeble or broken. Is any of you so sick or feeble? And the context here, just use it from the words that are there. The Lord will raise them up, and the prayer, the elders will actually pray over you. It's that sense of you are so beaten, you are so tired, you are so sick that you can't even get up. Is any of you sick? Call the elders. So firstly, you're called to pray for yourself, but second, you actually call out. When you are so beaten, you call for specialists, so to speak. Now, there's three things that he says of those elders. Number one, they will pray over you, they will anoint you with oil, and they will offer this prayer, which is not just a normal prayer, so to speak. He specifically calls it a prayer of faith in that verse there. And the prayer offered in faith, the NIV says, but the literal language says the prayer of faith. It is actually focused on prayer of faith, which links, as it were, to 1 Corinthians 12, for instance. So in verse 9, when we talk about spiritual gifts, it says, to each is given a manifestation of the Spirit. To one it'd be this, to the other it is that, and to another it is faith. So there is a gift, he goes on to verse in chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians, verse 2. Though I have faith, so as I could move all mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And it's in the context of this gift of, or an expression of, or a manifestation of God via his Holy Spirit of faith. So he says, call the elders to pray over them, and that gives you that suggestion that you're actually laying down, that you can't get up, and anoint you with oil. So what's the oil? Well, in the Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. He prepares a table for me in front of my enemy. He anoints my head with oil. At a very practical level, the shepherds, particularly you'll notice in those shepherding pictures, were a little bit different, like sheep farmers. The shepherds would literally stand out there for the most of the day with their sheep. And as they brought them in, be it to their own paddock or wherever it is, they would constantly be sort of checking them over. And if they found that they were wounded or so, they would actually apply or rub or massage in oil to that wound. Do you know what's really cute? Is the word anoint them with oil. Anoint is the same word for massage. Now, I don't have this picture of the elders coming over and massaging, you know, you're down on the bed and wounded and they're massaging fish. But it does give you an import of what the word, of what the oil is. It's about healing. It's about God's presence. And again, all the way through the Bible, constantly being anointed and my head running over, or when the priests were set aside, their heads were anointed with oil as a sign of God's presence and God's empowering. And so more than anything, it's a symbol of God's presence to restore, to heal, to set aside. So call the elders. Who are the elders? And it's curious, we were talking yesterday, and in practice, our church hasn't set aside elders. We have deacons, although in practice, many of our deacons function as elders. Just by way of a picture, there is something about, and I say this incredibly humbly and as one who feels totally unworthy, where Timothy says elders should be, and he starts talking about maturity and strength and steadfastness and the ability to not only look after yourself but then to stand forward and lead others. Huge burden. Paul says to Timothy, don't appoint elders too quickly. So this idea of calling the elders, you may even want to use the word shepherds. Again, reflecting, the Lord is my shepherd, but then very clearly God has sent the great shepherd, Jesus. And then Paul, as he established the church, appointed shepherds or elders to lead and care. And let's link it back to that 1 Corinthians 13:2. If I have faith to remove mountains, if I have these amazing gifts, but I don't have love, then I am nothing. Because it's those who are ministering don't have gifts because it's like, oh wow, he's a faith healer. But out of love, God graces us or empowers us to care for and minister to others. So call the shepherds to pray over them, to anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord, in an awareness and a dependence on the Lord. And verse 15, the prayer of faith. I would suggest, and I'm on the cusp of saying, I'm going to have to interject next week and look at a filling out of what it means, because if this is right, and James pushes us to not only pray for ourselves, but to call shepherds and to pray for each other, then I think we need to re-engage ourselves in what it means to be dependent and gifted or graced by God. Because the prayer of faith, or the faith prayer, which he is alluding to, the language is identical to the Corinthians there. It fits straight in with the manifestations of God's Spirit or the grace gifts, will make the sick person well. I just want to say, it seems to me that in practice, often when we go to pray, we pray because that's what I should do, and rightly so. But there are other times, and I've just seen a hint, even though very nervously, and Jessica and I think it was either 1 or 2 years ago, because it came up on Facebook as an anniversary a few weeks ago, we're in Darwin, and as we sat in the service listening, we went to Cornerstone Baptist Church, and this virtually never happens to me, but I was thinking about two people. One has been Josh, and it would be 2 years ago, Jessica, was it? One was Josh, and the other was Katrina. And I had this overwhelming picture of just God's brightness shining on and through them. And I very nervously said to Jessica, I just sort of saw them healed. And Jessica said, well, tell them. Go, no, don't tell them. And that's because what if I'm wrong? Like, you know, my nervousness. But there's a sense to which God, and it doesn't happen often, just gave me a glimpse. And we battle on 2 years later, and I ask you every week to pray for Josh. And we know that his leukemia is zero. Now, his body's not better. There have been times when I feared you know, and I say that genuinely, like we're going to lose him. Katrina is another person who gave a testimony here who for all intents and purposes should not be living. And yet the Lord has sustained and graced her in answer to, I believe, prayer. So the prayer of faith, and let me just suggest to you, well not suggest, I will teach you that in the Bible, the words when they put them together, spiritual healings or gifts of healing, are both plural. They are never singular. Gifts of healings. And that's quite important because gifts of healings, it gives you the sense that they are gifts that happen here and there and sometimes. So in other words, there is not a sense in the Bible of a gift of healing that you have all the time, full stop. There is not someone who has the gift of, but God gives gifts of healings as he chooses, is how 1 Corinthians says it. In other words, God will manifest himself as a response to prayer in faith here and here and here, but not a continuous all the time. I don't say that to undermine, but the gift of faith is like when you have that sense, and sometimes for some people, God gives that gift of God having the confidence, which fits in that if I have the faith to move a mountain, because Mark said it like this in chapter 11, 23 and 24, truly I say that whoever says to this mountain and does not doubt, but believes, it will be done for them. So ask and believe, and you have received. Now I've said this before, and I'm sure when Jesus said this to the disciples, they all sat there looking at the mountain behind them going, does anyone remember Luigi? Paul Hogan? He had the spoon, he's going, bend on a spoon. Bend on a spoon. The disciples were going, move at a mountain. Move, and the mountain didn't move. But Jesus is saying, if you have the faith and doubt, don't doubt, but you believe. And so I think that every now and then, which is more than we tend to think, God gives us the gift of faith to believe. God graces us or gives us a glimpse into what he's doing. And then we pray in faith in the light of that. Which puts the onus on the elders. This is where I am in fear and trepidation, and anyone else who would be considered an elder in our church, that we should be chasing or earnestly desiring the gifts so that we can express God's love. That is why in Acts the disciples, the apostles said, let us appoint deacons so that we can teach the word. That's not what they said. So that we can pray. So really, as a professional shepherd slash pastor slash elder, part of my job description, and anyone else who would consider themselves, whether you have the title or not, as a shepherd slash deacon, we need to be chasing God in prayer more than I do. That's not to say I don't pray. I was going to text someone this morning and I went, oh, it's only 5:30, I better not, to say that I'm praying for you. I've built that into my habit in the mornings to pray for members of our church. And that is something that is not just a responsibility, but part of God's calling as a shepherd. So calling the elders, the shepherds within our congregation, to come and to pray. I think the step before is that we are asking God, we are seeking God, what are you doing, what do you want us to do? And when he says the prayer of faith, the danger is this: you can approach it from like, oh, I have no idea, maybe God will just pray. I don't think we just pray. I think there's a whole lot of preparation and work that we do with God, earnestly desiring the gifts, the graces, the leading, the direction to keep up with God's Holy Spirit, that we would express God's presence in love. They will anoint you with oil, that you will recognize God's presence
and the Lord will raise them up. Curious that now, and in this, he starts to add to that. And if, there's three ifs in Greek. This one's a hypothetical, meaning if you have sinned, not your sin will be forgiven, but if you have sinned, because constantly God is more interested in our heart than our body. But if you have sinned, you will be forgiven. And James's whole letter has been about bringing our whole being, our heart, our mind, our will, our soul in line with God's heart. So you've had the first one, pray for yourself. You have permission. You have the invitation. James already said it earlier. You don't pray because you don't get because you don't ask. And when you do ask, you have wrong motives. You double-minded people. So firstly, you're allowed to pray for yourself. And in fact, that should be a natural response. Coupled with that, to praise. Secondly, if you are so beaten up that you can't get up to pray for yourself. And let me just say, I sent off a text/prayer to one of our beloved, because all these people were imposing and pressuring prayer on somebody who can't pray for themselves now. And so it's our job, when they can't pray for themselves, that they call, that we come and we pray for them. Therefore, now Ben made an interesting point last week on therefores. In the light of all of that, and because of all that, therefore confess your sins, verse 16, to each other, and pray for each other, that you may be healed. So there's three levels of prayer there. There's praying for yourself. There's that sort of ambulance call when you are so battered and bruised that you can't get up, that you call the shepherds to pray for you, to anoint you with oil as a sign of God's presence. And in the light of all that, you have the confidence to pray for one another. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. Church has built a culture, particularly, I can't tell you when it started, but I know definitely in the 60s and 70s, a culture built on, you can see it because we all dressed in our Sunday best. We all presented ourselves in our best, hence selfies. We come to church as best as we can present. And we cut off and we put outside the door and leave everything out there that's real and come in and go, how are you? I'm wonderful, thanks. Praise the Lord. Lamentations, Ecclesiastes says to lament and mourn. James used those same words. We did have a face-to-face service a couple of years ago, and while we were praying, someone sat there sobbing. So do you know what we do? We say, excuse me, just we're reading God's word. It's not the right time. No, we don't. We stop and we pray, being aware that God's presence is amongst us. Therefore, confess. If you confess, because notice what it says, not just healed, but linking on to the therefore, your sins will be forgiven. Do you know, sometimes you need to hear from somebody else that you are forgiven. Very clearly, Jesus said, those that you forgive will be forgiven, and those you withhold forgiveness from will not be forgiven. That is part of our ministry. We need to learn to speak the words, you know that in and through Jesus you are forgiven. We need to confess our sins and pray for one another, forgiving one another or pronouncing absolution on one another, that we may be healed. Because if the psychologists are right, a whole lot of our stress and anxiety and sickness is derived from guilt and a feeling or a sense of unworthiness. Therefore, encourage or give courage, give strength. If you go back to that word up here, if any of you are sick, and the word there is beaten down, crushed. So come back to here. Therefore, confess your sins that you might be healed. There is power in your prayer for each other. There is power, and it should be part of our daily routine / weekly churching. Now he wants to encourage us or strengthen us. So he does a little quote back. And let me be very clear. Some people believe, and I read it a few times throughout this last 2 weeks, that the miracles happened in three parts. One part of history with Elijah and Elisha. Sorry, first one with Moses and Joshua. Full stop. But then God started acting miraculously through Elijah and Elisha. Full stop. And we didn't see anything again until Jesus and the apostles, but then full stop. But James wants us, because look what he says about the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Hold on to those two words. Elijah was a human being just like us. So James wants to connect us with the power of faithful, righteous prayer on a man who is not elevated above all, but just like us. See what he says there? He was like us. He prayed that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. Let me come back to there. Because the command here is, therefore, in the light of prayer as a right response, and the prayer of faith, which will see God lifting us up, God anointing us, God strengthening us, God healing us, God restoring us, is attributed to confess your sins and pray for one another that you will be healed. I asked a question as we were 2 weeks ago, in the light of all that we're doing in our community, how does that become ministry? Guess what? We have been gifted or graced or empowered to do that no one else can do. We take the presence, the oil of God's presence, the anointing into our community. And so this part here does talk to our relationships within church. But very clearly, Jesus walked out of church, out from God's people, and into the world and the community. The prayer of a righteous person. Elijah was just, I want you to take that home with you tonight, today. Elijah was like you and like me. All the miraculous things that happened around Elijah were not attributed because he was extraordinary, because he's just like you and just like me. So to summarize and to finish it up, Elijah's prayer. James wants Elijah to be a model for us to imitate. James wants to encourage our and my prayers. James wants us to recognize that God is present with us and will lead us in prayer. James wants us to remember that God and his presence and his anointing actually heals and restores. Now, Jesus had a question at one stage when he talked to the disciples. He said, "Do you believe?" And the truth may be that I'm not sure. The truth may be is I'm not confident. The truth may be that we have been sort of blinkered into realizing the power of God's presence and to praying for each other, being led by God's presence, his Holy Spirit. We may not have actually said, "Lord, give us the gift the grace of faith. But I would suggest that God has been working regardless. But that doesn't mean that James doesn't want us to grow into maturity, because that's his goal. To realize the preciousness and the power of what we have. Let's pray. Father, I know I'm humbled by the words you write and feel weaker and unequipped. And yet, together, Lord, as a church, we desire to minister in love one to the other. We desire, Lord, to express your presence, which we know is outworked with your power. Lord, we want to be able to love not only each other, but our community. And that love wants to help to see folk healed, restored, lifted up, given courage to be called a child of God. And we know that you sent your Son that we could be called your children. And then when we were at our most unworthy and our weakest, Jesus stepped in our place. And now, because of his worthiness and the all-covering of his grace, he has poured out his Holy Spirit within our being. So Lord, empower us, I pray. Build up our faith, strengthen our faith, that we might pray for one another, that we might pray for ourselves, that we find not only physical healing but restoration, that you would anoint us with oil and restore us to our rightful place as your children. I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, let's... I'm not allowed to invite you to sing. I'm so sorry. I do hate that. But I'm sure that you can sing this song in your own being and you'll know it's "The Lord is My Shepherd," the traditional version now. So let's finish with being reminded that Jesus is our shepherd and he ministers to us.
Well, may God bless you richly. Go in peace. And let's fellowship together. Pray for one another. Encourage one another. Forgive one another. And not all while we have morning tea, but certainly as we fellowship together. Bless you lots in Jesus' name.